thank you. Can everybody hear me? Okay, yeah. It is a real thrill for me to be back here. I just want to thank Mark for that great introduction. That's one of the best ones I've ever had. Even if you did actually call me crazy in the middle of it. Which reminded me of a story I wasn't going to tell today, but I'll pass it along because it's an example of me having a faux pas during a talk that I gave. I was talking to a bunch of folks at Stennis Space Center at a formal dinner, something like this. They asked me to give some remarks. And I told them the story that I had about when you are trying to become an astronaut. You know, you interview, and then you go down, you're there for the interview, and once you're selected to be an astronaut eventually, they call you an astronaut candidate. And they abbreviate that and ASCAN. So the astronaut candidates are called ASCANs. And then I thought, well, what do you call somebody who's cut down there for the interview? They're not an ASCAN because they haven't been selected, but they're there. I said, they are astronaut hopefuls. So that's abbreviated asshole. Now, I told it to get that kind of laugh from everybody, but unfortunately, the Stennis Center director had interviewed to be an astronaut, and he said, Scooter, you just called me an asshole. I was like, sorry, sir, that was not my intent. But you calling me crazy made me think of that story where I called somebody worse, so you're off the hook. You know, it is good to be back here. This has been a great day, a couple of days, talking to the students yesterday, having the lunch, being here this morning, running in the race, talking to so many people, listening to Dr. Logsdon tell stories, reading the book Underneath the Elms that my dad has a couple of stories in. I think back to things that Ronald Reagan said, you know, everything good in my life began at Eureka. Everything in my life began at Eureka, you know. My dad has a story about him meeting a girl at a dance here in Eureka, and whirlwind romance later, they're married, you know, while they're students here. Now that I'm a parent, I can't imagine my 19-year-old coming home and telling me they want to get married while they're going to college, but I'm impressed, again, over and over again with my mom and dad for everything that you've done. So I just want to say thank you again to you guys. And I have tried to kind of grab a hold of the Eureka connection in that in 1959, when my mom received her diploma and walked across the stage, she was actually pregnant with me. So I am a graduate, in one way, of Eureka College. So it's been a great time. And I just want to talk a little bit today about the journey, how you get to be different places, and some of the lessons learned along the way. This is such a great place to get people started. I can't commend you enough for the work you're doing, President Arnold. The school, just the attitude around here has been awesome. So Eureka is really on its way. I'm so impressed. So this was my patch on my final mission. This is me in my simulator working environment. And these are the books. This is what space travel was when I was a kid, you know, looking at these kind of books and thinking about what it would be like. Walt Disney had shows on, and then Sky King. This is the TV show that I watched. I think it was in reruns back then, but maybe. And I said to my mom and dad, I'm going to be a pilot. And I was 3 years old back then. And they, you know, being Eureka graduates, they said, you can do anything you want if you work hard and give it your all and try your best. So I did. I went to, you know, in high school, I played basketball. Wasn't quite as good as Mark. I remember hearing my coach tell me when I was a freshman, I think he said, I actually was telling a reporter this, and I walked around the corner at the wrong time. He said, that Altman kid, he's 6'1". When he jumps, he's 6'2". Like, thanks, coach. So, but actually, my senior year at Pekin, we weren't a very talented team, but we learned how to play together. And we wound up having a pretty successful season. We went to the finals of sectionals, and Mark already knows I haven't let this go yet, even though it's been 30-some years. We played Peoria Central, who ultimately won the state championship, and we got beat by 9 points. due to some bad officiating, but I'm going to let it go one of these days and I'll forget about it. The point, though, is really that I learned on that team is that sometimes individual talent alone is not enough to get you where you want to go. You need to take people and get them to work together. And when you do that, you can do amazing things. You know, the same lesson I needed in the Navy when I was flying off aircraft carriers. I think that's my next slide. Yeah, flying the F-14. It was a blast to fly the F-14. But I wasn't the only guy flying it. The aircraft carrier, you know, 5,000 people, if they aren't all doing their job, I'm not going flying. I got a young plane captain who's 18 years old. He has to get the airplane ready to go. He has to break down the chains. If he doesn't do that right, I'm not going anywhere. If the catapult officer doesn't get the right signal from the kid who's rolling in the different numbers that I salute, and we put in a number lower than what my weight actually is, when the cat fires, I don't get 150 knots, I get 110 or 120, and the next thing, splash. Or the arresting gear has to get set for each different airplane. If you put the wrong setting in, it does one of two things. It either rips the tail hook off when you stop and you go dribbling off the edge, or all the arresting gear runs out all the way and you go dribbling off the edge. Both end results are considered poor form. So you have to depend on other people. That's a lesson that I really believe in. Teamwork is what makes it happen. This is an example of a different kind of teamwork. When I was flying in the mid-80s, the Russians were the enemy. They would fly these bear aircraft out to find the ship. We would launch fighters to intercept them and make sure we were with them before they could fire any missiles, if that was the idea that they had. So we have live ordnance on board. We think they had live ordnance on board. And it's this little game, but you never know when it could get ugly. And I mentioned that for a reason with one of my next future flights. This shot just reminds me of the flying we did for the movie Top Gun. Now, I don't want to spend too much on that. You probably heard some of those stories. You mentioned buzzing the tower and doing things like that. It was a lot of fun because normal pilots in the Navy, if you said, like Maverick did, "Goose, it's time to buzz the tower." When you land, there'll be a senior Navy officer there to rip your wings off your suit and tell you, "Go home. We don't want you flying our jets anymore." But because it was a movie, the guys at Paramount came to me and said, "You know, Scott, we're going to have a buzz the tower scene in there. We'd like you to buzz the tower. What do you think?" I said, "Okay." They said, "You know, we want to make sure we get the shot, so we'd like you to do it 9 times. I said, "Okay." I felt like I was getting pretty good at buzzing the tower by the time we finished that shoot. The actors, Tom Cruise, flew in my back seat. He was an interesting guy. He was very interested in flying. He became a pilot after the movie. Now he owns a P-51 and I don't. He was also somewhat vertically challenged. And the third thing is that, yes, he did fill his air sickness bag in my back seat. Just one last thing. We finished the movie, and they went off, and we finished filming. They went off to edit the movie together and put all the scenes in. And they looked at the landing they had for Maverick, and they looked at what they had for Cougar, the guy who was having trouble, and they said, "It doesn't look scary enough, what we have right now. So let's go back to the squadron and get one of those guys to see what they can do." They said, "Well, okay, who's the scariest guy around the boat?" And they said, "Well, it's pretty much Scott." So they had me go back. So when you watch the movie and Cougar's coming in all messed up like that, that was me flying an approach. Although I did try to make it worse than my average landing, but maybe not worse than my worst landing. So from there, yeah. Cruises are amazing things. You go across the world, surrounded by water, you know, in the middle of, literally, middle of nowhere. But it is some great flying, some beautiful scenery. I actually, this is probably a good time for me to mention my wife, who's here with me this time, because as it worked out in the Navy, I was in the training command, and at the very end, I did pretty well at landing on the ship and qualified, and they said, "Okay, you got good grades. You're going to a squadron that's leaving on cruise." Jill and I were going to get married in March, but this is September when they tell me I'm leaving in October. We said, "Okay, we can either get married when I get back, or we can get married before I go." I said, "If we get married before I go, I'll keep my BA, basic allowance for quarters, and I'll make money by being married. Good plan. So Jill put a wedding together within a month, and we got married on October 5th, 1984, also the day the Cubs lost to the Padres in the playoffs. Not that I carry that with me, too. You're kind of seeing a theme here. I don't let things go. But we had a wonderful wedding, and 13 days later, I shipped out for 7.5 months at sea. Came back and then went away to film the movie Top Gun. So Jill, you know, says in the first year, we had, what, about 4 months together? And she says that was the happiest year of our marriage. But so as a test pilot in the Navy, I had the opportunity to do a field trip. We went to Houston, and I realized two things. One, astronauts were actually real people. I don't think I knew that before. You know, when I was growing up with the moon landings, astronauts, like, wow, that's somebody way out there. But I met guys, and they had careers a lot like I had had to that point with the Navy. And I thought, that is the next step on my career. I want to be an astronaut. I want to go walk out and get in a vehicle and rocket off to space. So I applied, interviewed, came home. They said, if this guy Don Putty calls you, you're in. If you get called by a different astronaut, you're out. And so I was on travel, and they said, okay, Scott, call in, and we'll put the right person on the phone for you. So I dial Houston, and they say, oh, yeah, we got somebody here who wants to talk to you. And I'm, who's it going to be? Hello, Scott. This is Don Putty. And I'm like, I'm in. This is awesome. And he goes, I'm sorry to have to tell you this. I'm like, I'm out. So NASA said no the first time I applied. We don't want you. But I knew from experience in the past that when you really want something, you have to try for it. Don't forget. And I applied again. And the second time around, I was accepted. And I got to join NASA and do these kind of things. This is a picture from my first Hubble flight. And one of the things I like about this picture is if you look, you know, it's kind of a neat view of the Earth, but you look out at the top, you can just barely see a blue fuzz at the edge of the Earth on the rim. The first time I looked at that, I was like, what is that? And then I realized that's the atmosphere. For this big planet, that's as far up as the atmosphere goes. It really gave me a newfound respect for the planet. You know, that atmosphere is everything we need to live here on Earth, protect us from radiation, give us oxygen to breathe, and that just doesn't look that thick. This is one of my destinations, the space station, the way it looked like when I went there in 2000. And then this is the crew that I went to space station with, and this is a special story because I grew up wanting to be a fighter pilot and serve my country. Yuri grew up in the Ukraine wanting to be a fighter pilot and serve his country. He's one of the guys I used to go on cruise thinking, we're going to go head to head and I'm going to get the other guy, because that's the way you want to think in fighter aviation. But, you know, we were going to each try to kill each other. I was glad to have him as a crewmate instead. And I think that's something that space can do. As we work together, you can bring people together in pursuit of a common goal, which really is kind of one of my other central themes, working together for a common goal. So it was fun to have Yuri on the team with me, although some of my other buddies says, you know, wait a minute, he's behind you, which is what you don't want. Fighter pilots don't want the enemy to get behind you. But that shows we were friends. I didn't worry about it. This is what space station looks like right now. And this is my destination for my last two flights, the Hubble Space Telescope. Just an amazing instrument. It's really a time machine in a way, because the light it collects has been traveling for billions of years in some cases. So you're looking at the past when it gets here. And we can look back to the beginnings of the Big Bang, and they think they're getting closer and closer to that. 13.5 billion years is the furthest that light Hubble's collected. So it's a national treasure. And going to this, to work on it, you feel the pressure while you're going there, especially on the last mission, because it was the last time anybody was going to go there. Anything we didn't get done would never get done. So we got ready, working out in the shuttle simulator, practicing for all the emergencies, training in the big swimming pool called the neutral buoyancy lab in our spacesuits, working up at Goddard on the actual equipment in clean room atmospheres. This is something called the fastener capture plate, and there's actually already been removed right here a bar, kind of a handhold that would match this one and that one so that you could put the box in as an astronaut. Now it's already off, and you can see it has to be off to push this plate on. That instrument had failed with an internal power supply broken. So we devised this plan to get all, it never planned to be serviced in space. 117 tiny screws, non-captive, so if you unscrew them, they're gonna go floating off. And the rule in space flight is anything that can go somewhere will always go to the worst possible place. So we didn't wanna lose any of those screws, so they came up with this idea. Let's put a panel on the top, a hole to put the screwdriver through, and then the screw will float around in this little space right there, and we'll contain them all, and we'll pull this thing off. Great idea. Now, instead of flying a whole new box, we could just fly one power supply card like you have in your computer at home. This is how we figured out what we were gonna do, sort of your schedule for the day. 5 straight EVAs, all packed with different things. Our number one science objective at the top there, WFC, that stands for wide field camera. Basically, every time you go to Hubble, you try to reinvigorate it with new technology. This is a more detailed timeline, which talks about how, you know, we're scheduled basically into the minute intervals so that you have something to do every minute. You know, it's hard to get everybody up there, so you want to take advantage of every minute that you have. One of the things you do is you train for what the worst thing that could happen on the ground if there was a mishap on the pad. And one of the things you would do is slide down in baskets and then jump in this Arnold personnel carrier, we all called it the tank, and drive somewhere safe to get out of the big fireball. Everybody got their chance to drive, and we finally selected Megan, my MS-2, as our driver, because she was the only one of the crew that was willing to pull over and ask for directions. Now, have many people in the room seen the movie Gravity? A few, okay. You might remember in the beginning of the movie, they are working on Hubble, and something happens. Well, we were worried about what could happen, just like in the movie Gravity, and because it's actually physically impossible to get from Hubble to space station in a jetpack or in a shuttle or in any vehicle we've ever even imagined, that's this minor physics flaw in the movie Gravity. But I told him I was okay with that because it would have been a lot shorter movie if you didn't have anywhere to go. But KSC, I talk about teamwork, you know, NASA is the ultimate example of teamwork. KSC got our vehicle ready to go, and they got a rescue shuttle ready to go that it could launch within 7 days if something happened to us on the way up, or if we found a problem while we were in space. That shuttle would launch, rendezvous with us, and we would come home on it. My challenge then would be talking the commander of that shuttle out of his seat on landing so that I could land the shuttle that I was promised when I launched in Atlantis.
Fido, go. Prop, go. GNC,
go.
Max, go. Eagle, go.
Seven, six, four, two, one. And liftoff of Spaceship Atlantis.
Up till now, when you're sitting on the pad, you can almost convince yourself you're back in the simulator. And when those boosters light off, there's no doubt in your mind you are going somewhere.
Bypass across the board, scooter, no action.
We had our first failure right there. One of our flight control channels shorted out on launch. We had to diagnose that and work out.
Atlantis on its way, all three engines now throttling down as the air begins to hit the vehicle.
The solids burn for the first 2 minutes, and then they'll pop up. That's the next emergency we had. A little transducer failed, just like it did in the simulator when the instructors were getting ready to fail one of our shuttle main engines. which at that point, if that had failed, it would have required us to come back to Kennedy in what's called a return to alongside abort. A pretty hairy abort move where you actually flip the shuttle around and fly backwards through your own plume at Mach 5
until
you slow down.
You are go for orbit op.
Houston Atlantis, good words. Go for orbit op. Thank you.
Now, so some people go to space on the flight deck and other guys are on the mid deck. And when my pilot, Ray J, and I were talking about, okay, if we lose this engine, what are we going to do? We're going to do the RTLS. We'll flip around. Okay. And we're just thinking always about what the next worst failure is. So we're talking about that. And Drew on the mid deck said, that conversation totally ruined my enjoyment of the launch. But you're up there to do something. We get to Hubble. We're getting in your snowsuits to go outside and play in space. This is the wide field camera I mentioned, our number one scientific objective. It's held in place by a drive shaft that comes from the outside of it at the top all the way through down to a fixture right here that holds it in place in a very accurate way so that it will point and collect the air. Now, that drive shaft was supposedly torqued down to 45 foot-pounds. I'll tell a little bit about the spacewalk problem we had because Mark asked me. So the very first spacewalk we did was wide field camera. So you have to take WIFPIC 2, the predecessor to this, out first before you can put the new camera in. Well, WIFPIC 2 supposedly had been torqued down to 45. We had a whole set of procedures, put a wrench on it and undo the shaft. We went out there, Drew had the torque limiter on it, 45 pounds, which we thought would be enough, doesn't move. Okay, contingency says dial it up to the max, which is 48 foot-pounds, and try that, doesn't move. Okay, now what? The shaft was actually built with a little shear spot on it that would shear at 51 foot-pounds so that you wouldn't, you know, get this thing half in or out and get it stuck. So we knew 48 wasn't enough, and we knew 51 was too much. We didn't have a torque limiter that we could set to 51, so we went out there with the breaker bar, kind of like I remember working with on my uncle's farm on tractors, and said, Drew, okay, try and, you know, hit the sweet spot between 48 and 51. So he's out there, and I'm the commander, giving him a go, watching at the window, waiting to hear what he says, and he's got it, and goes, okay, it broke. It broke free, and I'm like, oh, I thought you meant it broke, but no, it's turning. It didn't break. Because I'm sitting there thinking, you know, our mission's going to be a failure right before we even get started. This is the second day's spacewalk. These little black boxes right here actually contain two gyros that help the Hubble point into deep space. You know, you have to be able to point very accurately to collect the light from the distant galaxies. Accurately enough that if I had a laser pointer, I was as good as a telescope was, I could be on the Empire State Building and hit a dime on the Washington Monument. So that's pretty good pointing. Well, to get that good pointing, you have to seat that thing very accurately. And we had a heck of a time getting that in after we got the old ones out. No gyros, telescope doesn't point. I'm thinking, okay, I'm going to kill the telescope again today if we don't get that done. But finally, we got it done.
Mike Massimino's reflection in the hat shroud of the Hubble Space Telescope as he prepares to open the doors.
Well, this is Mike Massimino doing a spacewalk.
Star Trackers,
he had the job of changing out those RSUs, the little black boxes I was just talking about. He's actually in a foot restraint right here, and we're passing things in and out. See, everything has a tether on it so it doesn't float away. It's poor form to lose parts on orbit. And
good job.
Michael, good. Now,
we actually designed that tool based on things you sometimes see in the grocery store to help hands down off a big shelf. We'll pick up. We built that to hold that box. He was happy to actually get one in. Now we're changing out the rechargeable batteries. Now, after 20 years, those double A's were all spent. So
new module.
We need to put something else in, and that's the battery box he's holding on to.
Taking them back to the telescope?
Yeah, I was.
Okay, good.
So I got to run the arm at some... Megan was our primary arm operator, and on some days, they let me get in there. Now, remember, I told you about that handhold. That's it on the box.
I don't want to strip the thing.
Yeah. That was a little late. It was stripped already. We got three of four bolts out. One of them was stripped. What do you do?
Houston, you ready for this?
We got to go for this.
Yeah, we're ready.
Okay, man, so you have a go.
Here we go.
Just break it off.
What has been the most dramatic part of these EVA shoots?
First, we start off wide field camera. Oh, yeah, our main objective, cold one might not come out. We almost break the drive run. Then we can't get the RSUs in. It goes long. Then you're out there, you got a bar that you had to break off manually.
Right.
What's up with, is that high tech? No, it's me in my garage.
The advantage of having people there, though, is the ability to respond to things that you didn't expect. This is this would be lunch on board the shuttle, a little less orderly than what we have right here, but able to take advantage of the vertical space. You can see I'm enjoying my shrimp cocktail inverted. This is Drew right there of the wrench fame. That's Mike Good of the RSU fame. I think this is John Grunfeld all hidden down there. And then Ray J is in the back. The kitchen is right there. So you can see you suck drinks out of packages like that. Your food comes in little pouches like that. And we had a stowaway on board with Snoopy up there, if you see him.
Camera.
That's so this is a little more about lunch on the shuttle.
Who is our flight engineer, and Megan.
It's actually the oven is right back.
Well, we just finished the starboard survey of the orbiter TPS, and yeah. I'm going to get my lunch. So I go to this locker here that says MS2 Meals on it, and I pull it out. It shows me all the food with the green dot that's mine that's in here. So I look up kind of what I want to eat. This is what I was looking for, ravioli.
Oh, man, it was great.
Very tasty.
I just had some.
Nobody tried this today, right, with their food? So that's lunch on the shuttle. This is how you work out. This is an example of how you sleep in these little sleeping bags clipped to the wall. I think Drew's reading them a bedtime story. This is where I slept up on the flight deck in case anything went wrong. I think I'm have a little laptop on my lap typing an email to my wife, let her know everything's good up here because I sent you so many, right? Yeah, okay, we'll stop with that. Looking out at the Earth when you have a spare minute is just incredible. You can't see it as well as I wish I could, but those little lights up at the top, we're flying over Africa, and there are these lightning storms, and it's like the whole continent is connected. There'd be a pop right there, snake of lightning over here, pop over there. It's like the planet was, you could hear it breathing through this lightning. It was just an amazing experience to watch at night. And you see some great sights, the Middle East. I cut a couple more. So this is me getting ready to come home. The one thing, you know, on the shuttle that makes landing a little more challenging in some ways than the ship is that you only get one chance. Every time at night on the ship, it was pretty scary in some ways, but you knew if things didn't work out, you took your left hand and ran it up and you went around and you had another chance to come back. Or if you missed the wires, you ran it up and you went around. The shuttle uses its engines for the last time 12,000 miles away from landing. You slow down about 300 feet per second. And it's just enough to drop you into the atmosphere and use the atmosphere to scrape off all your speed coming in. My first flight at night, we were coming in through about Mach 20, 20 times the speed of sound. I noticed this sort of greenish glow out my right window. I'm looking at, wow, that must be the fireball kind of getting those colors. That's why I floated up a little bit because the G hadn't really come on yet and looked out and it was a little more yellow up over there. So I floated up a little more. Now it got kind of orangish and I'm looking a little closer to the nose, and it starts to get kind of a dark red, and I'm like, ooh, I don't want to look anymore. That looks dangerous and hot out there. It was just an amazing light show to look at. But finally, you're a glider coming in with no power. This is, we landed at Edwards. We're coming through 9,000 feet. This is the airspeed, 300 knots.
Maybe we did get it.
Speed brakes are right here. My job is to hand fly this guidance so that the little diamond stays inside the little airplane. And then you look out at the real world and make sure what your instruments are telling you is what's really happening.
One's good, back to two. I'm decluttering.
Hey, I see the pull-up cues.
Next call is speed brakes, Megan.
Roger, at 3,000.
Okay. Yeah, so at 3,000, these speed brakes will reset to the place they think they should be for landing. And at 2,000, I start pulling the nose up, and the speed will start bleeding off as we're trying to target a position about 2,500 feet down the runway.
Looking for the ball.
Now, if you look next to the runway, you can kind of see a red series of lights and a white ball. The idea is to put that white ball in the middle of the red lights, just like flying the ball with the Navy, and that gives you your glide slope coming in here. I'm trying to hit 200 knots when the altitude goes to zero.
30 to 30.
Now, there's no guidance, so you're just kind of artistically playing at this point.
10 to 10, I agree. You're down. Nice.
That's touchdown.
25.
Derotating.
Good rate, wow, that's shooting.
We're not going to make the center turn off.
Okay, Scooter, I see,
So that's
here.
Landing. And then you get to get out and do a walk around of the shuttle. The thing you'll notice is your inner gyros are all scrambled after that. So when you're walking around looking at the orbiter, you're kind of woozy. And you get underneath and you want to look up at it, you better have somebody with their hand in your back because you go, oh. You have to go back. Your balance system just is not there yet. And it's amazing how heavy your legs are when you go to get out after being in zero G for 2 weeks. I just got a couple of Hubble pictures of a section of the sky where the stars are 100 times more concentrated than they are for us. The night sky would be 100 times brighter just from starlight. The Stefan's Quintet, five different galaxies that Hubble photographed all in one piece of the sky. The Butterfly Nebula, evidently our sun is going to do this in the relatively near future, something like 3 billion years from now, so we can sleep safe tonight, at least. And here's a shot of Jupiter after it got hit by a comet, basically an asteroid. And it's a little mark down here. The Shoemaker-Levy comet, you're like, oh, okay, not a big deal for a planet, until you realize that's the size of Earth. That'd be quite a mark on us. This is the Tadpole Galaxy. It's a soda straw view of the sky with this great galaxy, and it has, 100 billion stars or so in it. But the thing that amazes me about this photo is the background. That is a star. But every other dot of light here that doesn't have that little cross like that is another galaxy with 100 billion stars. They counted it. There's 1,500 galaxies in this one soda straw slice of the night sky, 100 billion stars in each. Soda straw. How many soda straws are there in, this is a big place. There's a lot of stuff out there. Now, I came to the end of my career. I'm excited to talk to students here. I talk to students at an elementary school. And I challenge them to be the next generation. Because I wanted to go to Mars when I joined NASA. Now I want to see somebody that I talk to be the person that carries that torch and takes us on to Mars. We're going to do great things in space now. Now people think we grounded the shuttle, NASA's over. NASA's not over. We're still flying people on the International Space Station. One of my best friends is up there right now. We have a test that's going to fly at the end of this year and bring us back at lunar return velocity, something we haven't done in the last 40 years, to make sure that the next generation space vehicle is geared up to do what we need it to do. We're building equipment like this at the Cape right now. There's the launch abort system. And this is actually that vehicle that's gonna fly the mission I was just pointing at that my company is assembling. So I'm still keeping my hand in the space game. Next slide. Okay. So that's what it's going to look like when it flies those missions. And that could be one of our targets, the moon. You know, I think we'll go on to Mars, probably fly in a spaceship that might look a little different from anything we have right now. But I think as long as we keep pushing ourselves and looking to the future, you know, we're going to be able to stand somewhere on Mars, look out at distant galaxies, and realize, yes, we really can reach for the stars. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much. That's so exciting. As we start to bring our program to a conclusion, it's my privilege to introduce a person that in a few short years has done what many in his line of work do not accomplish in decades. A person who is close to my heart. He has led our college to a point of physical strength. He's strategically invested limited resources in the lifeblood of the college, enrollment and retention, who dreamed of a new academic building that is now a reality, who brought together the individual intellect of the college to form and develop the white papers, and most of all, a person who has the good of the college I love at heart, the president of Eureka College, Dave Arnold.
Let's hear it again for Scott Altman. If you're not inspired after that talk, I don't think you got blood running through your veins. We have a presentation coming up to show Commander Altman our appreciation for his time, lots of time spent on campus. Commander Altman is the John Glenn of his generation, especially for us in Illinois. So I have a short story. It's not as funny as any of Commander Altman's stories, but it's a short story, and it's to connect the generations that preceded the space shuttle, the scientist, and I'm going to pick on our graduate from the class of 1950, Dick Joan. Dick started his career at White Sands. What do they do at White Sands? They look at missiles, okay? And he ended his career at GE working on jet engines. And we were comparing Pratt & Whitney and GE, and I won't tell Dick what the decision, you know, what the recommendation was from Commander Altman on engines. So this story is entitled, Sometimes It Does Take a Rocket Scientist. Now, I come from the school where we never let facts get in the way of a good story. So this is a good story. I can't confirm any of the facts. Scientists at NASA have developed a gun built specifically to launch dead chickens at windshields of airliners, military jets, and yes, the space shuttle, all traveling at maximum velocity. The idea is to simulate the frequent incidents of collisions with airborne fowl to test the strength of the windshields. British engineers had heard about the gun and were eager to test it on the windshields of their new high-speed trains. Arrangements were made to essentially have one of these guns. But when the gun was fired, the British engineers stood shocked as the chicken hurled out of the barrel, crashed into the shatterproof shield, smashed it to smithereens, crashed through the control console, snapped the engineer's backrest in two, and embedded itself in the back of the wall of the cabin. The horrified Brit sent NASA the disastrous results of the experiment, along with the designs of the windshield, and begged the U.S. scientists for suggestions. NASA's response was just one sentence: thaw the chicken. I'd like Commander Altman to join me at the podium, and this is a token of our appreciation, Scott, of your time spent with us. Thank you again, Scott, for a fantastic program today and a fantastic 2 days where you shared so much of your experiences of a true American hero. Our Director of Alumni Relations, Shelley Schwanke, will outline our afternoon activities as we close our luncheon. Thank you so much for coming, Shelley.
Thank you so much, Scott, for coming today. It's been very special to have you here for our Alumni Weekend. It means so much. And as it does to have all of you, I'm thrilled to have you all here today. And I just want to let you know that we now have a little time before our 2 o'clock presentation by Dr. Junius Rodriguez. We also encourage you to just linger and visit. Our bookstore is open. We have we also have a presentation at 3 o'clock. Sorry, I lost my place here. At 3 o'clock over in the Gammon Room in Mellick Library. It is a lovely afternoon, so if you care to wander around campus, all the campus buildings are open. We just encourage you to stay and enjoy your time here today. I'm sure that Scott will be available for pictures now and informal conversations. So I just encourage you to enjoy the rest of the afternoon. And this evening we have our wonderful celebration dinner where we will be giving out our alumni awards. So we'll be looking forward to seeing you then. Thank you so much.